Good turnout here. Does that reflect interest in biochemistry or anxiety about biochemistry?
Yes.
Or both? Yes. How's studying coming along? Good? Good? I was really pleased with the class yesterday. That was a fun sing-along, and I really enjoyed that. So I hope you guys did too. Thanks also to the singers. Really appreciated that. So I'm going to do here what I did last time. I did an overview. This is an overview today, and the overview is for materials since the last exam. So that will be covering glycolysis, gluconeogenesis, and glycogen metabolism. And I will do as I did before, go through the outline. And what I did was I took the glycolysis, gluconeogenesis outline, and then I, as you will see, I stuck it together with the glycogen outline, which is down here somewhere. It's so this creates a document that's different from the ones that are, I mean, it's not different, it's just the two stuck together is all it is. So you've already got this information in outlines, in two separate outlines instead of one. Okay, excuse me. So be happy to take questions or discussions as we go along. And let's dive in. So let's see, maybe I should get my pointer. Do that. That helps. If my pointer worked, it would help. It doesn't work. Does it work? Yeah, there we go. Okay. So, since the last exam, we've covered sugar metabolism. The only things we're missing out of sugar metabolism are what we will cover next term at the beginning of it with citric acid cycle. But as you will see, citric acid cycle isn't purely sugar metabolism, but it's the end part of sugar metabolism for sure. All right. Glycolysis. So I talked about glycolysis, how glycolysis is what I described as a central metabolic pathway. A central metabolic pathway is one that feeds essentially all the other metabolic pathways, and it's also central in the sense that it is a pathway that is found in virtually every living cell on the face of the earth. So it's why glucose is such an important sugar, and why glucose is in fact the most abundant sugar on earth. I spent a fair amount of time going through the reactions of glycolysis, and as I told you, I'm not holding you responsible for memorizing structures of things, except for things where I would already expect you to know structure. Things like glucose, fructose, galactose, which galactose doesn't directly appear in glycolysis, but it does indirectly appear, things like that. Hexokinase catalyzes the very first reaction in glycolysis. It is a reaction that requires the energy of ATP. And ATP energy is necessary to put that phosphate onto the position 6 of glucose, which is what's happening in the hexokinase catalyzed reaction. I talked about how if you try to do that phosphorylation in the absence of ATP, that is, you just use phosphate, to put it on, you see that energetically the reaction is not very favorable, and it's difficult to put that phosphate on, meaning that the reaction is favored in the reverse direction, actually. Okay. So ATP energy is necessary for that phosphorylation. That becomes later important later in the pathway when we learn something about oxidation. Hexokinase is one of the three regulated enzymes of glycolysis. And as I said in class, it's regulated by a sort of an unusual scheme, and so I don't really say much about it in the class other than to note that it is a regulated enzyme. It's not feedback inhibited, okay? At least not feedback inhibited in the sense that we've used that term. And hexokinase is also an example of what I called a coupled reaction. So coupled reactions, getting back to the ATP thing, are reactions in which the energy, a very favorable energetic reaction, such as the hydrolysis of ATP, is coupled to an energetically unfavored reaction, in this case, the addition of phosphate to position 6 of glucose. If you try to just make that phosphate go on by itself in the absence of ATP, as I said, it's an energetically unfavorable reaction. But in the presence of ATP hydrolysis, the energy of hydrolysis facilitates that addition of the phosphate. And consequently, you make a reaction when you couple the two together that is overall energetically favorable. And this reaction goes fairly strongly in the forward direction thanks to the energy from the hydrolysis of ATP. The second reaction of glycolysis is catalyzed by the enzyme phosphoglucoisomerase. And phosphoglucoisomerase is an enzyme that it really doesn't do much. It interconverts glucose 6-phosphate and fructose 6-phosphate. And these two things are not that different from each other. It doesn't really take any significant energy to make this happen. This is a reaction that occurs reasonably equally easily in the forward or the reverse reaction. So it works very well for gluconeogenesis, for example. Hexokinase, the first reaction I talked about, does not work well for gluconeogenesis, and it's for that reason that gluconeogenesis has a different enzyme than hexokinase to make glucose. Phosphofructokinase is the enzyme that I call PFK, and PFK is an enzyme that is the most important regulatory enzyme of glycolysis. And it's catalyzing a reaction that is very much like the hexokinase reaction. It's coupling the hydrolysis of ATP to the addition of a phosphate, in this case on position 1 of fructose to make fructose 1,6-bisphosphate. And that molecule, I didn't really say much about it in class, but that molecule is a fairly high energy molecule. You've seen it in one of the lists I had earlier in the term of high energy molecules. And that high energy molecule is important for that next reaction, which, as you see, is not very energetically favored as I've described before. The PFK I talked about later, and I will talk about it later here as well, is the regulated enzyme. And I did note in class that it's unusual for cells to have more than one regulatory step in pathways. And glycolysis is particularly unusual in having three regulated steps. The first step, which is fairly commonly regulated. The third step, which is a little unusual. But even more unusual is the fact that glycolysis has the last step of the pathway regulated. And I'll say more about that later. Okay. So the next reaction in the glycolysis pathway is catalyzed by the enzyme aldolase. And this is the enzyme that catalyzes the breakdown of fructose 1,6-bisphosphate into glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate and dihydroxyacetone phosphate. Now, this reaction is probably the most interesting reaction of glycolysis, I think, because it is energetically very unfavorable, okay, unless the cell does something. So the delta G0 prime for this reaction is over plus 20 kilojoules per mole. That's a lot of energy barrier for the cell to overcome. And I described in class two mechanisms that cells use to overcome the energy barrier of this reaction. I called them pushing and pulling. And pulling refers to removing of the product of a reaction. So the products of the reaction are glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate and dihydroxyacetone phosphate. So the removal of those will help to pull the reaction forwards. And I'd also described pushing, where pushing involves the addition of additional substrate to make the reaction go forwards. And we saw a little bit about how that happened. I described how when a cell gets a rush of glucose within it, like a muscle cell that has all of a sudden gotten a dump of glucose from, the bloodstream because there's the grizzly bear chasing them, that rush of glucose starts the pathway very well, but it gets stuck at aldolase because aldolase has that energy barrier. So as glucose starts, or actually in this case, as fructose 1,6-bisphosphate starts accumulating, because all the glucose was accumulating, then we see that the pushing is actually starting to happen. Okay. The other thing that happens, of course, as the fructose 1,6-bisphosphate accumulates is it activates pyruvate kinase. And pyruvate kinase is that very energetically favorable big bang reaction at the end. And it's actually the mechanism for pulling all of those intermediates after the aldolase reaction. So by jump-starting the pyruvate kinase reaction, that is how the mechanism of pulling happens. And of course, what starts that pyruvate kinase reaction? The answer is the accumulating fructose 1,6-bisphosphate. So not only is fructose 1,6-bisphosphate pushing the reaction, as seen here, but it's also activating the pulling by turning on pyruvate kinase at the very end. So fructose 1,6-bisphosphate plays that very, very important role, both roles, essentially, in the pathway. The next reaction is a very simple reaction. It's catalyzed by the enzyme triose phosphate isomerase. And triose phosphate isomerase is the one that interconverts glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate and dihydroxyacetone phosphate. That reaction is reasonably favorable in either direction. And so it's an important reaction for both glycolysis and for gluconeogenesis. And this was an enzyme that I described that was interesting because it was a perfect enzyme. And this perfect enzyme is important because during the catalytic process of interconverting glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate and dihydroxyacetone phosphate, during this interconversion, there's an unstable and toxic intermediate that actually forms. And so if this toxic intermediate were allowed to sit around for any period of time, it could kill the cell. And so having a perfect enzyme, which is an enzyme that rapidly runs through this reaction before that toxic intermediate gets a chance to accumulate, turns out to be very important. And so that's one of the reasons, or actually it is the reason, why triose phosphate isomerase has evolved to the point of perfection as it has. Excuse me. The next enzyme in the pathway, glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate dehydrogenase, is the enzyme that catalyzes the only oxidation that's in the glycolysis pathway. It's the only oxidation. Okay. This reaction was interesting because the starting material is glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. Sorry, we had two molecules of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate after the triose phosphate isomerase reaction. We have a glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, and the product of the reaction is 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate. And my question in class that I raised was, well, how is it that this phosphate gets put onto this glyceraldehyde molecule without the energy of ATP? And the answer to that question was that what's happening in the reaction is it's an oxidation, and the energy of the oxidation is providing the necessary energy to put that phosphate onto the glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate to make glyceraldehyde 1,3-bisphosphate. This molecule, this reaction is very dependent on NAD because the cell has a limiting quantity of NAD. And it's because of this need for NAD that cells do fermentation. This is the reason cells do fermentation. And I'll talk about that when I get down to the section on fermentation. But this supply of NAD must be abundant in order to keep this reaction moving forwards in the glycolysis direction. Excuse me. Okay, the next enzyme is phosphoglycerate kinase. And it catalyzes the first of what I described as two substrate-level phosphorylations that occur in the glycolysis pathway. Yes, question. This reaction here? Yeah, I'm sorry, this one here, triose phosphate isomerase? This one, okay. And what was the question? That's a good question. I want to say it's not too far off of zero, but I can't recall off the top of my head. Yeah. It's not a factor in terms of reversibility. It's not really a big factor in terms of reversibility. Okay. Yeah, back there. 6.3, okay. So that's not too far off of zero. Yeah, thank you. No. Just the ones where I've mentioned there's big gaps. And I'll tell you right off that the big gaps occur on four reactions: hexokinase, PFK, aldolase, and pyruvate kinase. That's the four. And you don't need to know the numerical values, though. That's just needless memory. But you should know that those have some interesting energy considerations. Okay. Other questions? Phosphoglycerate kinase catalyzes the first of two substrate-level phosphorylations that occur in glycolysis. So what's substrate-level phosphorylation? Substrate-level phosphorylation occurs when a high-energy molecule donates a phosphate to ADP to make ATP. Okay? I'll repeat that. So substrate-level phosphorylation occurs when a high-energy molecule donates a phosphate to ADP to make ATP. Well, no surprise, it takes a high-energy molecule to do that. If you remember, at the very end of the material for the last exam, I showed you the structure of ATP, and I pointed out you got these three phosphates hanging off the end of that ribose sugar, right? And I said each of those phosphates was negatively charged. They repelled each other, and that's the potential energy that's stored in there. So if you're going to put a phosphate onto ADP, you better have something that's got enough energy to overcome that repulsion that's going to exist with the negative charges. And that's actually why a high-energy molecule is necessary for substrate-level phosphorylation. I mentioned in class that there are three kinds of phosphorylation that cells do. The first that we learn is substrate-level phosphorylation, which is what we're talking about here. And I'll talk about the reaction in a second. I haven't even talked about the reaction yet. The second is oxidative phosphorylation, and that's what occurs in the mitochondria. Okay, we'll talk about that next term. And the third is what plants do and photosynthetic bacteria, and that's photophosphorylation. That is, they use the energy of light to make ATP. So those are the three ways in which ATP is made in the cell. Okay. The reaction, which I haven't told you about here, involves the transfer of a phosphate from 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate onto ADP to make ATP. And that yields 3-phosphoglycerate. Okay? Now, the intermediate in... I'm getting ahead of myself in terms of intermediate. That reaction is a substrate-level phosphorylation. And the product of that, after the phosphate's been removed, is a molecule called 3-phosphoglycerate, or 3PG. Okay? That 3PG plays a role in that next step that I'll talk about that involves the mutase. Okay. The next step is catalyzed by phosphoglycerate mutase, and this is the enzyme that I pointed out what mutases do. Mutases catalyze reaction by not by transferring a phosphate from one position to another, but rather by adding a second phosphate and then removing the first one. So if you want to go from 3-phosphoglycerate to 2-phosphoglycerate, that's what this enzyme is catalyzing. There's an intermediate in the process, and the intermediate in the process is 2,3-bisphosphoglycerate. Okay? 2,3-bisphosphoglycerate. After that 2,3-bisphosphoglycerate has been made, the phosphate at position 3 is removed, and you're left behind with the final product, which is 2-phosphoglycerate. Now, I mentioned in class how 2,3-bisphosphoglycerate is stable. It leaks out of the enzyme sometimes. And as a consequence, the more glycolysis is going on, the more 2,3-bisphosphoglycerate will accumulate. And so 2,3-bisphosphoglycerate is used by the cell as a barometer, or maybe a thermometer, a measure of the amount of glycolysis that's actually occurring in the cell. So when we think about cells that are rapidly metabolizing things, they're going to have more 2,3-bisphosphoglycerate. And 2,3-bisphosphoglycerate, of course, was the molecule that binds to hemoglobin and favors the release of oxygen. So these things pair really nicely. This makes really good sense because now we've got an indicator of high metabolism, and it's telling the hemoglobin, here's where to dump your oxygen. And that works out really well. Now, I talked about in class two ways of making 2,3-bisphosphoglycerate, one that started with 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate, and to be honest, I don't think that's a very important one in the overall scheme, but I showed it to you so that you're aware of it. Yes, sir? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep. Okay. Good question. So it's actually a very good question. So why would cells grab it, and why isn't it causing them to get oxygen dumped at that point? Okay. Keep in mind that we're talking about billions of hemoglobins, and we're talking about thousands or hundreds of thousands of these 2,3-bisphosphoglycerates. So in the scheme of things, the dropping off of a few here or there doesn't significantly impact cells that aren't rapidly metabolizing. That's number one. And number two, why are they grabbing it? Well, they're grabbing it, of course, because cells grab anything that they can use for energy. And so that 2,3-bisphosphoglycerate can just plug right into this phosphoglycerate mutase and continue glycolysis. So the cell has basically gotten a free dump of energy, and that's why they're doing it, okay? But the amount that a resting cell is taking in is not going to significantly change the environment that's there, okay? Good question. Okay, so what I was saying is that the 2,3-bisphosphoglycerate can be made by a couple of mechanisms. One that's sort of general for all cells, and it can come from 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate, and that doesn't really tell much about the metabolic state of that cell. The one that comes, let me back up on that. The one that comes from 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate is not from all cells. It's actually from some specific cells, blood cells, for example. Okay. The mechanism that I described to you with the mutase that indicates the level of metabolism, that reaction is found in all cells. So now it becomes a barometer, a very good measure of metabolic activity in all cells. The first reaction, or the other reaction, which is the 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate becoming 2,3-bisphosphoglycerate, happens only in blood cells. Okay, there's an enzyme, and I won't go through here, but the enzyme I showed does that in class. Okay. The next reaction in the process is the setup for the grand finale, and that's the reaction catalyzed by enolase. Enolase simply pulls a water out of 2-phosphoglycerate and yields the molecule phosphoenolpyruvate, or PEP. That is necessary because what happens in that process is creating a molecule that has very high energy, very high energy. PEP is what I described as the most energetic molecule that's found in cells. Yes, Aaliyah. It pulls the water out of 2-phosphoglycerate. So 2,3-bisphosphoglycerate, again, remember, is not a glycolysis intermediate. So we're only following the glycolysis pathway here. Okay? Yes? So when the cells pick up 2,3-BPG that's lying around in the bloodstream, they're just going to grab it. It's going to go into the mutase. Because this mutase, I said this is a stable intermediate, means mutase can let go of it, but mutase can also grab hold of it. So as it grabs hold of it, it says, oh, wow, look. And now it makes 2-phosphoglycerate, and then glycolysis continues. So, but that's what it's doing. Okay? Okay. Let's see. Last reaction catalyzed by pyruvate kinase. Pyruvate kinase reaction is what I call the Big Bang reaction, and that's because there's so much energy here. There's enough energy to make a second ATP. The energy is not used to make 2 ATPs, and so a lot of heat can be produced by this reaction. And this is one of the reasons, one of many reasons, not the only one, but one of many reasons why when you exercise, you get hot, because you're producing this excess heat that's not being captured in the form of making ATP. Okay? Very important. Yes? Mm-hmm. So why is reaction 7 not the same as pyruvate kinase? Okay, because the precursor in reaction 7 is 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate, and that doesn't have as high of an energy as PEP does. Yeah. And so keep in mind that we're making two ATPs there, but we're also making it with two molecules. We're making two molecules of 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate creates two ATP and 2,3-phosphoglycerates, right? In this reaction, I'm talking about two PEPs going to two pyruvates, but I'm saying there's enough energy there to make four ATPs instead of two. That's what I'm saying, so two for each one. So that's how much extra energy is there. That much extra energy is not present in reaction 7. Okay. Pyruvate kinase is what I described as the third regulated enzyme of the cycle. That third regulated enzyme of the cycle is important. And the reason it's important is that if it is not turned off, then cells that are doing gluconeogenesis will waste a fair amount of energy making PEP, which would then immediately become pyruvate catalyzed by this reaction. So we would be making a very tiny futile cycle if this enzyme could not be controlled. And this enzyme has to be controlled. That's why the last enzyme of glycolysis being regulated is important. And that doesn't happen with virtually any other pathway in the body. Okay? But this is a very, very important reaction here. Okay. Pyruvate, I noted, had three fates. One fate that is when oxygen is present. In all aerobic cells, what will happen is acetyl-CoA will be made. That is, pyruvate will be decarboxylated. Pyruvate has three carbons, and acetyl-CoA has two carbons, meaning it's lost one of its carbons. That occurs in all aerobic organisms in the presence of oxygen. Now, why? What's the key to that? Why in the presence of oxygen? The reason that's important is because oxygen is necessary, as we will see next term, for producing NAD+. Okay? When oxygen is present, the electron transport system runs and NAD is produced. When oxygen is absent, then electron transport system cannot run and NADH will not be produced and NAD plus will not be produced, and NADH will accumulate. Okay. So the other two conditions relate to the absence of oxygen for the reason I just stated. One is for bacteria and yeast. And with bacteria and yeast, we see that they produce ethanol. And the reason that they produce ethanol is because they can take pyruvate, convert it to acetaldehyde, and then they can use their electrons of NADH, give it to acetaldehyde, and make ethanol, which is what we think of fermentation occurs, and produce NAD+. So they're producing that NAD+. Animals have a different way of making that NAD plus in fermentation. So yes, we do fermentation, just like bacteria do. We just have a different product. And the product that we have also starts with pyruvate. But instead of starting with a decarboxylation, we reduce pyruvate to lactate. I reminded everybody that lactate was not lactose. Lactose is a sugar. Lactate's a little three-carbon molecule. And lactate becomes lactate by the addition of electrons and protons from NADH onto pyruvate. That's what creates lactate. That's catalyzed by the enzyme known as lactate dehydrogenase. My startup disk is full. I'm going to tell it to quit notifying me about that because I'm getting rather annoyed at it. Don't warn me again. What will happen is my computer, when it will just simply explode. And when it explodes, then you will know that I have exceeded the capacity of what my computer can hold. So, yes. Yeah, good question. Do I care if you say lactic acid or lactate interchangeably? In general, I don't care. I don't care. Technically, lactate means that the proton is off of it. Lactic acid means it's not, and I don't give a shit. We've gone through that phase where we worried about the proton being on and proton being off, and we're not going to worry about it with respect to names. Okay? Be quite blunt about it. But okay. All right. Let's see. So lactic acid, of course, is produced commonly by our muscles. And I noted that people think that, or some people think that heavy exercise causes muscles to be sore because a lot of lactic acid is produced at that point. Lactic acid is soluble in the bloodstream, as we saw in the Cori cycle. So how true that is, people argue about that a lot. Okay. So the whole reason for fermentation is balancing NAD plus and NADH. The reason for that's important is cells have a limited quantity of NAD plus and NADH. So it's a continually recycled molecule, and recycling is important, and that's why fermentation is important. Yes, sir? Yeah, it's a very good question. Does lactate have to go back to the liver to be made into glucose, or can it just be in the cell? The answer is absolutely, it's got to go back to the liver to get made into glucose, because only liver cells and kidney cells can do gluconeogenesis. So can lactate be used in cells? I think that's the other question that you might have. Can lactate be used in cells? And the answer is it can. So lactate doesn't have to go into being made into glucose. It can't be further oxidized. It can't be further oxidized. It can't be converted into something else. The only thing lactate can be converted back into is pyruvate, the thing it came from. So a good exam question could be, everybody's perking up now, a good exam question could be, okay, well, when would the cell be able, after making lactate, what would be required for a cell to make it back to pyruvate? What do you suppose? What's that? But what would the cell, what would have to change in the cell so that the lactate could be used back to pyruvate? The combination of your two answers are right, okay? So you need oxygen and you need mitochondria because that's where the electron transport system is. That's what's necessary to regenerate NAD. And if you have plenty of NAD, now you can reverse that reaction, right? Make sense? Now, why do I tell you that? I'll tell you that this isn't something that you're responsible for, but this is something a student actually taught me. So I like to learn from my students, and this is a very cool reaction, okay? Lactate is a very important nutrient for your heart. And when I first heard that, I thought, what the heck, right? Why is lactate such an important nutrient for my heart? Lactate's a dead end. Well, think about what's happening. When you're exercising, what's happening? As I said, you're not responsible for this, so. Your muscles are producing a lot of lactate. It's going to the liver. That's the thing I showed you in the Cori cycle, right? In the Cori cycle, the liver is making glucose, but the liver's got a lot of stuff to make glucose, so it's not like every molecule of lactate has to go back to the liver to make glucose. The heart's sitting here going, hey, buddy, I'm doing some hard work. I'm going to grab some of this lactate that's coming through. The heart has plenty of oxygen. The heart is right next to the lungs, and so with plenty of oxygen, it's got plenty of NAD. So what's the heart doing? It grabs the lactate, it makes pyruvate, going backwards, and now pyruvate it sends through the citric acid cycle to make all that ATP. Pretty cool, all right? So that Cori cycle has a little side arm that goes off of it to the heart that actually feeds the heart, and the heart really likes lactate, apparently. So that was kind of cool. Okay, let's see. I think I've said enough about that. Other sugar metabolism. I talked about metabolism, how other sugars enter the pathway. One thing I forgot to say, and this was kind of a bummer because now I can't test you about it, but I'll tell you here. You won't be responsible. I'm joking, but I'll tell you about it. Actually relates to galactose. So galactose, I showed you how that UDP glucose could come in, swap with the galactose, and make UDP galactose. And then an epimerase flipped it to UDP glucose, and everybody was fine. So that each time that little cycle turns, you dump out a molecule of glucose-6-phosphate, okay? Or glucose-1-phosphate, I'm sorry, glucose-1-phosphate. Every time that little thing turns, you get an extra glucose-1-phosphate, you get another galactose grabbed, and so forth, all right? What I didn't tell you that I meant to, and it's actually important for health considerations, is that if that pathway gets screwed up, or there's problems in getting that pathway through, what happens is galactose accumulates. So anytime galactose in your body accumulates, the body tries to detoxify it. Here's another piece of evidence that things like glucose are poisonous. Right? As galactose accumulates, the body will reduce galactose to an alcohol sugar called galactitol. Why do we care about that? You care about that because accumulation of galactitol causes it to, it will actually crystallize, and it can help to start to form cataracts. So having too much galactitol, or galactose, ultimately, because of problems with this pathway or other things, can lead to the formation of cataracts. So I forgot to say that in class, though. So, oh well. Absent-minded professor. So actually, the question is that why diabetes can affect your eyesight? Diabetes actually affects your eyesight because it affects your retina. And you can actually go blind, whereas you can get cataracts removed and stuff. It may well be that you actually form some additional cataracts as a result of that, but the real problem with diabetes is actually more important problems with the retina. Yeah. Okay. Let's see. Lactose. Lactose was a very simple one. Lactose, of course, is milk sugar. It's a disaccharide, and lactose is broken down by the enzyme known as lactase. And lactase is, it breaks lactose into galactose and glucose. It's one of the major sources of galactose in our body. And I talked about lactose intolerance, how there is a sort of profile that some people have with respect to having not enough lactase made as they're adults. And it tends to be more commonly found in Asians than in other people, although lactose intolerance is abundant around the world. And the reason that appears most likely is because as adults in the evolving world that we came from, we weren't drinking milk. And we actually, I think I mentioned in class, we actually have evolutionarily gone back and found where the mutation occurred that favored our bodies making lactose as adults, and that mutation occurred almost at the same time as the development of organized agriculture. So when we started domesticating cows, we started drinking a lot of milk, and we now began favoring people who actually were able to digest milk as adults. And so that was kind of a cool piece of evidence of evolution in action, as it were. Okay. The other sugar metabolism I mentioned was fructose, and fructose, I pointed out, was really problematic, from the Ahern perspective, I should emphasize this is Kevin Ahern's theory of obesity, it's my own. I have no idea whether I'm not doing research in this area, but it makes logical sense, I think, to talk about why high fructose and or high carb diets lead to obesity. And the answer is, I think, because fructose can be metabolized into glycolysis, through the reactions that I showed. I talked about a fructokinase that put a phosphate on fructose at position 1. I talked about a fructoaldolase that split the fructose 1-phosphate into a glyceraldehyde and dihydroxyacetone phosphate. And then I showed you how the glyceraldehyde can be converted to glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, and so we have the dihydroxyacetone phosphate and the glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, the same things that we have in glycolysis, but we've bypassed hexokinase and we've bypassed PFK. So that is problematic because now what you do is you're force-feeding glycolysis. Once you get things to the dihydroxyacetone phosphate and the glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate state, glycolysis is going to occur, which means you're going to start making pyruvate whether you want it or not. And when you start making pyruvate, the only thing cells can do with it from an energy perspective is they break it down to acetyl-CoA, and acetyl-CoA is the starting material for fatty acid synthesis. So it's kind of a long description, but the point is, high carbs will favor that fructose pathway that I've just described to you. So it's not just fructose alone, although fructose alone would probably be the worst thing that you could take, all right? But fructose or high carbs will force that fructose pathway and favor the production of fatty acids. Okay. High fructose corn syrup, of course, is a major source of fructose. And does anybody know why high fructose corn syrup became a big factor? You actually have to treat, okay, corn syrup with an enzyme to make it have high fructose. Anybody know why that's the case? Why that anybody ever wanted to sell it? Yeah. Well, it may be a little bit stabler than glucose. That probably is a factor, but I'm not sure that it's stabler than sucrose. Okay? So it is stabler than glucose is, but it's not probably stabler than sucrose is. It's not cheaper to make, no. All right? But you're on the right track. This is when I learned this, it really pissed me off. Okay? Yeah? It's slightly sweeter, but that's also not too much of a factor. The factor turned out to be that it was cheaper to use corn sugar than it was to pay import taxes that were being done on sugar, on sucrose. And so they said, okay, well, we've got plenty of corn around this country, which is true, and we've got plenty of corn syrup that can come from that. So as a consequence of a penny or so of a tax that was on sucrose, all right, they decided to make high fructose corn syrup because they could. So economics, okay. All right. Enough ranting and raving, Ahern. Gluconeogenesis. Okay. So gluconeogenesis is the pathway by which we make glucose. And gluconeogenesis is very similar to glycolysis in reverse, with the exception of the three glycolysis reactions that are replaced by four gluconeogenesis reactions. Okay? So that's important to understand. Those four gluconeogenesis reactions are bypassing energetically unfavorable steps in the reverse reaction. The first of those was catalyzed in glycolysis by pyruvate kinase, and that's the Big Bang reaction. And I pointed out how in gluconeogenesis, cells have to take two reactions to get around that. The first of those is catalyzed by pyruvate carboxylase. Pyruvate carboxylase is the enzyme that's found only in the mitochondrion. Okay. And it is a carboxylase, meaning it's taking carbon dioxide or bicarbonate and grabbing it and putting it onto something. In this case, it's putting it onto pyruvate, and that creates a molecule known as oxaloacetate, or OAA. That reaction requires energy from ATP. And also requires the coenzyme known as biotin. Biotin is that carrier of carbon dioxide that I talked about in class. After the oxaloacetate has been made in the mitochondrion, it has to be moved out into the cytoplasm because that's where all of the other reactions of gluconeogenesis, except the last one, occur. And by the way, I didn't say it earlier, but all the reactions of glycolysis occur in the cytoplasm. All the reactions of glycolysis occur in the cytoplasm. Okay, the second enzyme is known as PEPCK, phosphoenyl pyruvate carboxykinase, for those who want the full name. And PEPCK catalyzes the breakdown of oxaloacetate into PEP. Okay, it's breaking down oxaloacetate, making PEP. That also requires energy. And the energy used here is most commonly GTP. Most commonly GTP. Okay? What else can I say about that? Some cells use ATP. So I've had a couple students online that asked me questions. They'd seen something online saying, oh, this uses ATP, not GTP. And it depends on the organism that you're talking about. So, but most commonly, GTP is actually the energy source for this reaction. The next enzyme of the gluconeogenesis pathway, you can see my brain starting to slow down. The next enzyme of the gluconeogenesis pathway is fructose 1,6-bisphosphatase, or if you want to call it FBPase-1, that's also okay. That is the enzyme that replaces PFK from glycolysis. And I talked about how this enzyme uses a cool trick to make its reaction be favorable, and that is it doesn't try to regenerate the ATP. Instead, it clips the phosphate off of position 1 of fructose 1,6-bisphosphate, because that phosphate bond has some energy. It uses that energy to help it go forwards in the gluconeogenesis direction to make fructose 6-phosphate. But the advantage is it doesn't have to remake that ATP, which would take additional energy and make the reaction be unfavorable. So the product of the fructose 1,6-bisphosphatase reaction is fructose 6-phosphate. Phosphoglucomutase kicks in like it does in glycolysis, now catalyzing the reaction in the reverse direction to make glucose 6-phosphate. And then we get to the last enzyme of the gluconeogenesis pathway, which is glucose 6-phosphatase. And glucose 6-phosphatase is very much like the fructose 1,6-bisphosphatase. It uses the energy of the phosphate, clips it off, and creates glucose. Doesn't have to regenerate the ATP. Okay, so that's the those are the reactions and the enzymes of the pathway. All the other enzymes of the pathway are the glycolysis enzymes, reactions being run in reverse. Okay. The regulation of the pathway is important, and I talked about feudal cycles and reciprocal regulation. Okay, so let's talk briefly about those. Yes, question. G6PAs replaces hexokinase. That's correct. I'm sorry, I should have said that. Yeah. Okay, yeah, question. Where does the phosphate go? It just floats around the cell. Cells are full of phosphate. And they're not trying to avoid synthesis of ATP. It makes it sound like they don't want to. The reality is that if they did the perfect reverse of the reaction, they would have to make ATP. And that takes energy. So they're avoiding it in that way. Okay? They're avoiding it in that way. Another thing to think about, I didn't mention it in class, but I'll also, because I like you guys to think physiologically, right? If you think about what's happening in gluconeogenesis, when's a cell going to be going through gluconeogenesis? Energy is high, right? When energy is high, cell's going through gluconeogenesis. So if I go to that fructose 1,6-bisphosphatase reaction, the PFK reaction, and I said I had to remake ATP, I said that's energetically unfavorable, right? Everybody agrees with that, right? And that's true. There's another reason that cells don't want to do that. And you guys have just told me what it is. There's already a lot of ATP there. So a product being high in concentration will make that reaction be even more unfavorable, right? So under the conditions that are there, the cell does not want to make more ATP because it's going to make that reverse reaction, that's why the reversal of the reaction isn't done. So otherwise, it would be making so much ATP, it would never be able to do anything. Okay. One of the things we'll see next term, I'll just give you a little insight onto that, is that we talked about NAD and NADH being limiting and that they're recycled. So too are ATP and ADP. And so if you have everything as ATP, you no longer have things present as ADP. And that's actually a problem in some cases, as we'll see. Okay, feudal cycles. What's a feudal cycle? A feudal cycle occurs when the catabolic and the corresponding anabolic pathways are occurring in the same place at the same time. I talked earlier about regulation of pyruvate kinase because I said if the cell didn't turn off pyruvate kinase while it was doing gluconeogenesis, then it's going to make PEP, and then it's going to break it down into pyruvate. It's going to make it into PEP and break it down. That's a very small feudal cycle, just going on and on and on. Feudal cycles don't do anything except burn energy and create heat. If the cell wants to make heat, that's okay. But for the most part, cells don't want to do that. So cells put very elaborate, I shouldn't say elaborate, but very important schemes together to prevent feudal cycles from happening most of the time. Okay. One of the common mechanisms that's used is what's called reciprocal regulation. And reciprocal regulation occurs when an action or a molecule or a treatment has opposite effects on catabolic and anabolic pathways. So a really good example, AMP I talked about. AMP is a molecule that's an indicator of low energy. AMP inhibits fructose 1,6 bisphosphatase. It activates PFK. Opposite effects. Fructose 2,6 bisphosphate similarly has opposite effects on fructose 1,6 bisphosphatase and PFK. It activates PFK. It inhibits fructose 1,6 bisphosphatase. So, thinking about reciprocal regulation in that sense is very, very important, because one molecule or one thing, and the reason I say one thing is when we saw glycogen metabolism, we saw the thing was phosphorylation, had opposite effects. It wasn't a molecule, but it was actually a covalent modification that had opposite effects on things. Yes? Which one? So fructose 2,6 bisphosphate activates PFK, and it inhibits fructose 1,6 bisphosphatase. That is the corresponding gluconeogenesis enzyme. Is that a question? Oh, I thought you said something. Okay. All right. So AMP in general will be indicators of low energy. Okay. AMP inhibits, I think I have on a slide, inhibits pyruvate carboxylase to a limited extent. Okay. And that makes good sense if you think about it from an energy perspective, because what does it take to make glucose? Energy. Do you want to start the pathway out if you don't have enough energy? No, you don't. So if you knock out pyruvate carboxylase to start, bang, you have stopped the gluconeogenesis pathway from occurring. Okay. ATP, on the other hand, indicator of high energy. So ATP, we want to see, and we will in general see ATP activating things that favor enzymes necessary for gluconeogenesis, and they will inhibit things favoring glycolysis, because again, we don't want to be breaking down more glucose if we already have plenty of energy. I said that fructose 2,6 bisphosphate was the most important regulator. It's actually the most sensitive regulator, and probably is in fact the most important regulator as well, of glycolysis and gluconeogenesis. When it is present, it binds to PFK and favors it, and it binds to fructose 1,6 bisphosphatase and inhibits it. Okay? Very important reciprocal regulation. However, its absence is interesting. So we saw the mechanism that involved the breakdown of fructose 2,6 bisphosphate. Its absence actually slows down PFK. I didn't say that in class, but it actually slows it down. PFK really likes fructose 2,6 bisphosphate. So when it's not present, PFK is way slowed down. Leah? Sure. So fructose 2,6 bisphosphate activates PFK, and it inhibits fructose 1,6 bisphosphatase. It does the same thing as AMP. That's correct. Yep. Yes? No. So some things you can look at and you can say, okay, here's low energy and so forth. Fructose 2,6 bisphosphate is just simply a molecule the cells make to do its thing. And it's interesting that, and you're not alone, most people worry about fructose 2,6 bisphosphate. Well, what is it? It's just, okay, I could make a red flag and say, okay, you go out here and carry the red flag, and that'll indicate that we're going to go fight, right? And it's just an icon is really all it is. Whereas other things tend to be, you know, you could say, well, AMP is an indicator of low energy because cells are burning their ADP to make it. And when they're burning ADP, they got problems. So it is a signal is all it is. Yeah. Ron? ATP will inactivate pyruvate kinase, yes.
So would it say to say since it's a reciprocal regulation that it would act as an allosteric activator for either
pyruvate carboxylase? Okay. Yep. Now I mentioned in class that PEPCK didn't really have much in the way of allosteric effectors. The biggest regulation of PEPCK is whether or not it's made. So PEPCK is made in liver cells and kidney cells. It's not made in other cells. So right there, you can knock out gluconeogenesis pretty readily by not making it. I did say that there were, and this is way earlier in the term, but there are three ways of regulating enzymes, right? You remember what they are? Allosteric, covalent modification, and synthesis or not, right? And availability of substrate is actually another one, but I didn't. I'm not sure I said that one, but anyway, yeah.
In one of your lectures, you mentioned that F26 bisphosphate was made upon insulin stimulation that favors glycolysis. Wouldn't it be epinephrine stimulation?
I'm sorry, could you repeat the question again?
So this F26 bisphosphate mm-hmm. is made upon insulin stimulation and that favors glycolysis. Wouldn't it be, if this molecule was made of like an epinephrine stimulation that goes to glycolysis?
So, all right. So I'm not sure I'm going to be able to answer your question coherently, but I'll try.
Sorry,
that's fine. No, it's me. The coherence part of the problem is me. It's not you. So, all right. So insulin is going to favor reducing blood glucose concentrations. It does two things to do that. One is it favors the uptake of glucose, and once it gets that glucose in the cell, it's got two things to do with it. It's got to either burn it, which is glycolysis, or it's got to make it into glycogen. So both of those inside the cell will effectively reduce the free glucose concentration, right? And they seem counterintuitive. One's a breakdown pathway, one's a synthesis pathway, right? Okay. But it underlines the importance of glucose being a poison. Make sense? Okay. It is confusing. I won't argue it's not, but it is confusing. Yes? Yeah, so PEPCK is, as I said, there are allosteric effectors of it. They don't play a major role in its, I showed a figure that had that. Yes, you're right. But the most important thing is whether or not it's made. Yep. Good questions. Okay, let's see, where am I? I am about ready for the pentose phosphate pathway, unless there's other questions there. Okay, so first of all, what is PFK2? If I asked the class that, what would you say? What's PFK2? What reaction is PFK2 catalyzed? Anybody? Synthesis of fructose 2,6-bisphosphate. That's what PFK2 is. PFK1 catalyzes synthesis of fructose 1,6-bisphosphate, right? Okay, so PFK2 is the enzyme that has the other activity on it, the fructose 2,6-bisphosphatase, or the FBPase2 that you can call it if you want. And the enzyme flips between one activity versus the other depending upon whether it's phosphorylated or not phosphorylated, right? Okay. So phosphorylation favors what? Which activity? Madison?
The breakdown of FP6 and the activation of gluconeogenesis.
Yes. So phosphorylation favors breakdown of fructose 2,6-bisphosphate, which is where it means it's favoring the FBPase2 activity. Right? Okay. Why is that? When is that going to happen? Epinephrine or insulin? there's a divide in the class. Okay, good. All right, let's talk about it. So what phosphorylates the the enzyme complex? What phosphorylates it? PKA. And when's PKA active? Epinephrine, right. Okay, so when you are favoring, all right, the phosphorylation of this enzyme, you're favoring the breakdown of of fructose 2,6-bisphosphate. And what happens when you break down fructose 2,6-bisphosphate? No. Remember, no. Fructose 2,6-bisphosphate is needed for PFK. So if you break down fructose 2,6 bisphosphate, you're going to favor gluconeogenesis.
Oh my gosh.
That's where your confusion rose. It's backwards?
So one of my notes says that the favors of glycolysis, 2,6-bisphosphate is made upon insulin stimulation, and then in another, but in another lecture, it's F26-bisphosphate when it's correlated by epinephrine.
All right. So since there's confusion, let me pull up the actual figure, because we're talking about it in words, and I'll get you guys even more confused. Okay. All right, hang on. All right. So we've got keynotes. That would probably be. Oh, don't tell me. There they are. Okay. Here. All right, now let's see. It would be here, this is the reaction, right? Okay. Now, let's go through this. So, you have PFK2 that catalyzes the formation of the fructose 2,6 bisphosphate, right? Okay. That will happen when do I have it backwards? No, it's not backwards. No. So you want to make, and I just told you backwards here is what I said, is what I did wrong.
Okay.
So you want to make fructose 2,6 bisphosphate so that you can run glycolysis, and that's going to happen when you have insulin.
Okay.
Right?
So a protein kinase A
yep.
adds that phosphate to the protein.
Yep.
Because of epinephrine.
Yep. So that means you're going to have the synthesis of fructose 2,6 bisphosphate occurred. No.
Because of breakdown and then glycolysis
is activated. Under what I have. You know, that's. There is something inconsistent here, guys. Very good. Yeah. Okay. So I tell you what, I will do that, and I'll clarify that for you, because it may take me 5 minutes standing here just looking at it to make a difference with that, and I think it's a good suggestion. So I'll do that, and I promise I'll clarify whatever is issue in there, okay? Okay. And I'd also say come see me. If you'd like to, I'd be happy to just step you through it
okay. And
see. When I screw it up, then it's even worse, right? So it is a confusing problem. But let's come back to that. I think that
okay.
makes sense, okay?
Good.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yep, sure. Sorry for the confusion, guys. Oh, yeah, I can see this is going to go downhill from here now, isn't it? So, okay. If reasonable, yeah. Give everybody 20 points, right? I mean, that would seem reasonable to you. You're saying the singer should get the extra points? Is that what you're saying? I had a feeling it'd probably be the case. So. Okay. All right. Let's talk about the pentose phosphate pathway, which is something that makes a little bit more sense up front, right? Pentose phosphate pathway is, I described, as an interchange of other pathways. That's really what it is, okay? You'll notice it's not, I didn't talk about anything about regulation of the pathway, all right? And that's because there aren't any greatly energetically favorable, unfavorable reactions that are occurring there one way or the other. And that makes it a very good interchange, okay? It's not like you're getting onto a toll road where you have to pay a lot to do it, right? So the toll, so you've got basically exchange of information going all different directions. The pathways that I described in there that were important were glycolysis, gluconeogenesis, nucleotide metabolism, and aromatic amino acid metabolism. Those four pathways all either feed or take things away from that pathway. Now, I talked about the primary importance of the pentose phosphate pathway being production of NADPH, okay, production of ribose 5-phosphate, okay, feeding those pathways. Yeah, NADPH production, ribose 5-phosphate production, feeding the pathways, and interchanging sugars. That's really what's really happening here. If you have glucose, you can make it into ribose. If you have fructose, you can make it into acetohepulose. Okay. Okay. The pathway reactions, I said you didn't, I wasn't holding you responsible for knowing the reactions or even knowing enzymes except for the ones that I briefly mentioned. The two most important enzymes there are the transaldolase and the transketolase. I broke the reactions down into three groups: oxidations, isomerizations, and carbon rearrangements. And it's in the carbon rearrangements that the transaldolases and the transketolases are important. Now, the beauty of the pathway that I talked about is that you can start with intermediates from glycolysis or gluconeogenesis, for example, and convert them into components for nucleotide metabolism. You can convert nucleotide metabolism intermediates into glycolysis or gluconeogenesis intermediates if you want. So there's no direction to the pathway. The direction depends upon what the input material is and what the output material is. Question? So yes, what I said about transketolase, I think you should know. Yes, yes, okay. And transaldolase as well. Yeah. Okay. So the inputs and outputs are critical. What are the inputs? Well, inputs are things that the cell has an excess. The cell has an excess of glucose 6-phosphate, or let's say fructose 6-phosphate, then we've got glycolysis gluconeogenesis intermediates in abundance. Those will be inputs. If the cell has a shortage of ribose 5-phosphate necessary for making nucleotides, that becomes the output, because that's the direction that the pathway is going to move to put things out. So learning that simple thing about the PPP is really the most important component of the pentose phosphate pathway. Okay. We move from there into glycogen metabolism. And glycogen metabolism, as I noted in class, is the simplest metabolic pathway you'll ever learn. It's very simple. Glycogen is broken down by an enzyme known as glycogen phosphorylase. That's a phosphorolysis reaction, meaning a phosphate is added and used to clip off a glucose. Okay. That creates glucose 1-phosphate, and it's the equivalent of a hydrolysis where water is used to clip off a molecule. But the advantage for the cell is by using a phosphate, they can bypass the need to use an ATP to make that phosphorylated glucose form. The reason that that's possible is because, ooh, Oh, that didn't sound good. Nobody heard, I hope. Okay, a mutant virus has now been released into the room. Everybody's going to die. But it's been nice knowing you guys. Yeah. Why is it called a phosphorylase and not a phosphatase? A phosphatase is something that removes phosphate from things. A phosphorylase is something that uses a phosphate to clip something off. Very big difference, yeah. The difference between a phosphatase and a phosphorylase is that a phosphatase removes phosphate from something. A phosphorylase uses a phosphate to clip something off. So in this case, it's using a phosphate to clip off that glucose to make glucose 1-phosphate. Now, phosphorolysis reactions, of course, require energy. We saw that it took energy to put the phosphate on to the glucose, right? In glycolysis. So it didn't require energy here because there was energy already in that 1,4 linkage. Yes? I'm not sure I understood the question again. So, all right. So, okay, let me try to answer your question. So, the output of this pathway for the breakdown, of course, is going to be glucose 1-phosphate. Glucose 1-phosphate readily made into glucose 6-phosphate. Then the cell can either make that into glucose. One step, right? And it's got free glucose. So if it's a liver cell, it's a really simple way to make glucose. Or if the liver cell says, hey, I need some energy, then it's going to take that glucose 6-phosphate and it's going to go through glycolysis. Okay. So either is possible. And again, depending upon the needs of the cell. Make sense? Okay. So glycogen phosphorylase, first enzyme. Product, glucose 1-phosphate and a glycogen 1-carbon shorter. Okay. Phosphoglucomutase, important enzyme. Enzyme that interconverts glucose 1-phosphate and glucose 6-phosphate. That's partly answering her question there, interconverting those. So glucose 1-phosphate can readily be made into glycolysis gluconeogenesis intermediates from that using that enzyme. Okay? Third enzyme, debranching enzyme. Okay? Debranching enzyme is necessary because glycogen phosphorylase doesn't work within 4 units of a branch point. So debranching enzyme grabs 3 of those, moves it further down the chain, makes 1,4 bonds, and then it clips that 1,6 bond using water. And that was evidence that the 1,6 bond didn't have as much energy as the 1,4 bond did. You're frowning. Yeah, so debranching enzyme catalyzes 2 things. First, it grabs 3 glucoses from the end of a branch and moves it to another part of the glycogen molecule and makes a 1,4 linkage. So it shortens this branch, but it lengthens something else. The one glucose that's left behind at the branch is clipped off by a hydrolysis reaction. And that's the only free glucose that's released in the glycogen breakdown pathway, is that last one. And that was evidence that there's not as much energy in an alpha 1,6 bond as there is in an alpha 1,4 bond. Because the alpha 1,4 bond, we could clip it with a phosphate, right? We can't use a phosphate here. There's not enough energy to put the phosphate on to make that happen. Yes, sir? So the reason is probably related to that, yes. Yeah. Yeah. Hexokinase. If I said that, that's not right. So hexokinase simply makes glucose 6-phosphate. Well, I mean, it'll also make fructose 6-phosphate, things like that, because it works on a variety of sugars. But I don't remember saying anything about glycogen metabolism. So it's in that direction, yes. Yeah. Leah? Okay. Oh, and that last glucose. Oh, I see. Because that, that's you're probably right. So the last glucose, of course, doesn't have a phosphate on it, so that's where you would use hexokinase. Right, okay, thanks. Yeah, I didn't think about that. Yeah. Oh, sure. Okay, so her question had to do with, I mentioned hexokinase with respect to the debranching enzyme. Okay, and Leah had the answer to it. So with the debranching enzyme, you're making free glucose. And with free glucose, if you're going to use it in glycolysis, you've got to use hexokinase. Yeah, yeah. I'm thinking glucose 6-phosphate, but of course that's not present with debranching enzyme. Yep. Okay. All right. Good questions, guys. You're thinking about stuff. So there's the three enzymes of glycogen breakdown. You basically have three enzymes, or four depending on how you count them, for glycogen synthesis. The first being the synthesis of the activated intermediate. The activated intermediate is UDP glucose. The starting material for that is glucose 1-phosphate and UTP. And the enzyme catalyzing that is UDP glucose pyrophosphorylase, which we decided to call Larry. Okay? That makes that activated intermediate. An activated intermediate, you may remember, is a molecule that has a high energy bond that uses energy of that bond to transfer a part of itself to something else. So an activated intermediate is a molecule that has a high energy bond, and it uses the energy of that bond to transfer a part of itself to something else. Well, in the case of UDP glucose, the part of itself that's getting transferred is glucose. And that glucose is going on to a growing glycogen chain. It makes an alpha-1-4 bond. And this is other evidence that there's energy in that alpha-1-4 bond, right? Because we have to use a high-energy intermediate to put the glucose on there. Okay, second enzyme, glycogen synthase. Glycogen synthase is the enzyme that catalyzes the addition of that glucose. And the third enzyme being branching enzyme, which simply creates the branches that we know are present in glycogen. Yes, sir? Is the G1P going to come from G6P? It could, yeah. Yep. Okay. Regulation, that's where it got big, complicated, and hairy. But I try to keep it reasonably simple for you. Glycogen phosphorylase, right there, has two different covalent forms. One form that has phosphate, one form that doesn't have phosphate. The form that has phosphate is known as glycogen phosphorylase A. That's the form that people refer to as being more active. It also has a form called glycogen phosphorylase B that people refer to as being less active. Okay? Glycogen phosphorylase A is allosterically regulated by glucose. When glucose is present, glycogen phosphorylase A will flip into the T state. Glucose is, however, not very commonly present in abundance. And so consequently, when there's no glucose, glycogen phosphorylase A will automatically flip into the R state, which is the more active state. Okay? Glycogen phosphorylase B, on the other hand, is allosterically regulated by ATP, glucose 6-phosphate, and AMP. ATP and glucose 6-phosphate will cause it to flip into the T state. Makes sense. High energy, turn it off. AMP will cause it to flip into the R state. Okay? That ability to flip into the R state with AMP, I said, was important for muscles again. We see over and over this thing about muscles needing energy really, really quickly. So AMP will accumulate as muscles deplete their ATP stores. And when that happens, you want to have sources of energy available as quickly as possible. So that means that that allosteric flip happens instantaneously when AMP appears. And now glycogen phosphorylase B flips into the R state and starts breaking down glycogen, giving you glucose for making ATP. Okay. Let's see. Yeah. Good question. So, is GPB working before GPA, or are they always working in tandem? What do you think? Well, let's think about this. Okay. So, it's a very good question. It's one I wish I had thought of for the exam. I haven't written the exam, so I guess I could still use this. okay. All right. So, cells usually have a sort of a mixture of GPA and GPB present, unless they're getting dinged by a hormone or by insulin or something, okay? So they've got a mixture of these two guys present, and the muscle cell takes off and does its thing. It's going to make AMP, right? And when it makes AMP, it's going to favor GPB going into the R state, which means GPB is going to be active, bang, right? What happens to GPA? It will stay active because, again, once you take off running, that glucose is going to get started burned to do things. So they're going to work together. They're going to work together. So that answered your question, okay? Good question. Other questions? Okay. The scheme that I showed of the epinephrine pathway brought about phosphorylation. So actually, rather than just talk about it here, I'm going to pull that up just so that you've got something to look at besides my words. What did I do? Oh, blast it. Okay. Let's see. Where's my glycogen metabolism? Come on. Okay. So the epinephrine pathway right here. Okay. All right, so I showed this in class yesterday. There's the stimulation from the hormone, activation of the G protein, activation of adenylate cyclase, production of cyclic AMP, activation of protein kinase A. Protein kinase A phosphorylating two things, phosphorylating glycogen synthase, and this is where I said was the root of the reciprocal regulation, because glycogen synthase A, when it gets phosphorylated, is inactive. Protein kinase A phosphorylates phosphorylase kinase, which in turn phosphorylates glycogen phosphorylase to activate it. This way inactivation, this way activation. Okay? And as you've seen, it's not purely activation. Cells can have phosphorylase B active under certain conditions, right? So that's what we think about this being the more active form and this being the less active form of glycogen phosphorylase. Okay? Usually, phosphorylase B is not going to be active. Usually, it's not. Okay. And once the cell starts putting us onto here, you're not going to really have much phosphorylase B left behind anyway, because it's all going to go over here to this form. Okay. Okay. So that's what's happening with that overall regulatory scheme, and that's an important consideration for the control of the. Actually, let me leave it on there for a second. Control of glycogen metabolism. So, reversing that is what's important here. Okay? So, there's your phosphorylation cause right there. If we're going to turn off this signal, we've got several things to turn off. Earlier in the term, I showed you how we turn this guy off with a protein called arrestin. You saw how the G protein has a GTPase activity that causes it to break down GTP back to GDP. I talked about phosphodiesterase breaking down cyclic AMP to make, in this case, AMP. It's not shown on there, but you break down cyclic AMP and you no longer have it. Therefore, the protein kinase A will flip back to the inactive form. And then you've got to get rid of all of this phosphorylation business that's happened. And that is what happens with the phosphatase. So phosphoprotein phosphatase removes the phosphates and reverses all of this. So epinephrine causes this to happen. Insulin reverses the very final steps of all that. Okay? And self off, broken down. Yeah, okay, there. All right, we were nearing the end. I'm just going to finish off with these slides here. Okay. This showed the two ways in which phosphorylase kinase became active. Yes, question. There is a relative abundance, and certainly once the hormone is doing its thing actively, it's going to really strongly favor one versus the other. But prior to that, there's just a mixture of the two. Yeah. Okay. Fully inactive form of phosphorylase kinase when it has no calcium and when it has no phosphorylation. And I pointed out that either the lower pathway or the upper pathway can occur first, but to make it fully active, both have to happen. So if you go this pathway first, that is putting calcium on it first, then the second thing that'll happen is it's got to get phosphorylated if it's going to become fully active. If, on the other hand, you have it phosphorylated first, then to get it fully active, you've got to add calcium to it here. Leo. That should be off of there, yes. Good observation. The phosphate should not be on there. You're right. I'll remove that off of there. So I screwed you up, huh? Okay. Yep. Well, you know, in a lot of ways, you guys are my guinea pig class because you're the first one that I've taught from this book with. And, of course, you always discover... One of the things that when Indira and I wrote the book, that we had no proofreaders, we had nothing. I mean, we did the whole thing ourselves. And so I don't mean to sound big-headed or be bragging here, but I will tell you I appreciated very much what proofreaders do because you'll look at something like I've looked at this figure probably, I don't know, 50 times, including teaching a class with it, and didn't notice that phosphate's on there, right? I was an author about 15 years ago on a traditional textbook, and all I had to do for it was write stuff, and the proofreader and everybody took care of everything. I said, put a figure, and they did that. And so this was hard. So anyway, you guys are guinea pigs. Thank you for being guinea pigs and also for helping us to see things like that because that was one thing I just didn't see. Yeah. So when you're confused, sometimes there's a reason why you're confused. It's because Ahern was confused when he put it together. I will fix it. And what I've been doing is that's why I'm marking those things in class sometimes is making those changes so that I know that they're getting changed and I don't have to remember to do that later or something. So I will get that changed and I'll post that. So thank you. And I apologize for confusion with that. But that should have phosphates off. Yes, definitely. Okay? Now everything makes sense, right? So now I can ask a really hard question about this? No? What if that's your extra credit question? So anyway, I talked in class about how this getting calcium being activated by calcium partly was important. And that was, again, getting back to these muscle cells, that when muscular contraction happens, the first thing that happens is the concentration of calcium in the muscle cell goes up, and that calcium combined here and immediately activate this guy. So we don't have to wait to start phosphorylating those enzymes to break down glycogen. It happens immediately with muscular contraction. So that's a very simple mechanism. This mechanism, which goes down here, takes longer because it has to wait for the hormone to flow through the bloodstream to get to the target cells. And as I said, you don't want to be waiting for your ATP synthesis to kick in when you're trying to get away from the grizzly bear. So this bottom one is slower. This one is instantaneous. Okay? And when the hormone kicks in, then you're going to have this going on here if it's a muscle cell that we're talking about. Okay? Okay, so what did I have? I had epinephrine, I had glucagon. Glucose levels are low. I went through this a little bit quickly yesterday, but I'll just go through a little bit more slowly here. Epinephrine or glucagon increase glucose concentration by favoring glycogen breakdown and inhibiting glycogen synthesis. And if I put another and on there, what else would you say? What else is epinephrine and glucagon going to favor? Synthesis of glucose. Right? Going to favor the synthesis of glucose. And it's going to inhibit the breakdown. I shouldn't say it's going to inhibit the breakdown, because that depends on the cells that we're talking about. So I don't want to make that conclusion. Insulin, on the other hand, is going to counter that system. It's going to stimulate the phosphatase. That's going to favor glycogen synthesis. That's going to inhibit glycogen breakdown. And I saw that you're doing the and. What's the and? What's it going to favor? It's going to favor glycolysis, which is reducing the concentration of glucose. Right? Okay. Ta-dum. All right. So when glucose is needed, epinephrine glucagon stimulates the phosphorylation and the release of glucose from glycogen. When glucose is abundant, stimulates dephosphorylation and the incorporation of glucose into glycogen. Okay? And this last observation, which somebody asked me a good question about this after the fact, and I'll point it out here. So the observation was, if you start with purified enzyme, GPA and GSA, and you add glucose to it, they almost immediately become GPB and GSB. So what's going on? So this is a really good example of where I like to have you, I give you some information, and then you use your head to think about what brought this about. So what's the information that you've got? The information that you've got is started with these, ended up with these, but what does this mean compared to this, and what does this mean compared to this? Well, in each case, you've lost phosphates. So you've got to think, the first question you should ask yourself is, well, why did they lose phosphates? And why was it related to the addition of glucose? And the clue is the fact that glucose is an allosteric effector of GPA. It's an allosteric effect. So now you start putting things together and you say you did something to GPA that favored the removal of phosphate. What in the heck could it be? Well, that's what a scientist at one time had to do to figure that out when they did this experiment. And they saw this happen. They had to figure out what was going on, and this is what was going on. They discovered that. That's how you discover things. You see something that you don't know what's going on, and you find an explanation for what makes sense with that, and then you go out and you look to see if you can purify these things in the tube and determine that. Well, this turned out to be the case. What they had was they started with a GPA up here in the R state, and they added glucose. When you add glucose to GPA in the R state, it goes into the T state, which means it changes shape. And when it changes shape, it lets go of this little monstrosity down here. This guy, this PP1, is phosphoprotein phosphatase. And it is blocked, its activity is blocked when it's bound up here. Can't function here. But it's wide open here. That's why it's got its little mouth showing. All right? It's wide open. So now this thing can start dephosphorylating things. And there's only two things in the tube for it to dephosphorylate. GPA and GSA. Right. Okay? And so that's what it does. And so when you dephosphorylate them, you convert them into GPB and GSB. Yes, Leah? Is it B to A? Okay. I couldn't remember which one it was. Yeah. So B is the, I guess B is the inactive form of that. Okay. So that's what's happening with the phosphatase. And so it's a really cool, it's a really cool scheme. And I will tell you that there's another aspect of this I didn't mention in class that I'll mention to you here. Okay. Let's go back to that muscle cell. That muscle cell is sitting around doing nothing, right? And the muscle cell, when it's doing nothing, what's happening? Well, the muscle cell is making glycogen, right? It's making glycogen. And once that muscle cell starts contracting instantaneously, it does not want to make glycogen. The muscle cell is getting feedback from the rest of the cell. There's some glucose being dumped in, perhaps from the bloodstream. Okay. And as glucose concentration starts to accumulate, this synthesis pathway gets turned off so that it's not wasting the glucose that's coming in. It's going to burn it for energy. This allows it to instantaneously turn off synthesis and turn on I said it backwards. Sorry. This is breaking down glycogen. Okay. When this is breaking down glycogen, the cell, the muscle cell, has been using energy, right? The muscle cell has been using energy. The muscle cell goes to rest. What happens when the muscle cell goes to rest? Is it going to be burning all the energy that it's making? No. So the muscle cell is going to have start seeing pathways back up. ATP concentration is going to be higher, right? ATP concentration gets higher. Glycolysis is not going to occur, right? No longer a need to continue making ATP. Glycolysis no longer occurring. What happens to glucose concentration? It's up because the cell has been bringing the glucose in from the bloodstream, right? Glucose concentration goes up. You want to turn this guy off so you don't break it all down and then have to start it all back up again because that's going to be a futile cycle, right? You turn that off, and consequently, you want to now favor the inactivation of glycogen phosphorylase at the same time as you are favoring the activation of glycogen synthase. And that's what's happening. Okay. So this allows for a rapid turn-off, turn-on of glycogen metabolism. That's the bottom line. You don't need to know that since I didn't talk about it in class, but I'm telling you this separately. But that's why this thing is carrying the phosphoprotein phosphatase as best as anybody can tell, is that rapid ability to switch on and off the glycogen synthesis and break them. All right, you can tell. My brain has stopped working about 20 minutes ago, so I hope the last 20 minutes of what I said were coherent. I will write that explanation for the fructose bisphosphatase 2 stuff. You can if you want to, but I'm going to make it available for the whole class, so it's up to you. But if you want to come by, I'm happy to meet with you. The final is in link. Yes. The final is an hour and 50 minutes. For a rapid turn-off, turn-on of glycogen metabolism. That's the bottom line. You don't need to know that since I didn't talk about it in class, but I'm telling you this separately. But that's why this thing is carrying the phosphoprotein phosphatase as best as anybody can tell, is that rapid ability to switch on and off the glycogen synthesis and break them. All right, you can tell. My brain has stopped working about 20 minutes ago, so I hope the last 20 minutes of what I said were coherent. I will write that explanation for the fructose bisphosphatase 2 stuff. You can if you want to, but I'm going to make it available for the whole class, so it's up to you. But if you want to come by, I'm happy to meet with you. The final is in link. Yes. The final is an hour and 50 minutes. I'm going to put 3 times as much stuff on it, so you guys will be all set. I'm joking. I'm just looking to see if anybody's paying any attention, okay? So they would cut my head off is what they would do. I'd be dead. If you guys want CDs, come down. I'll give you some CDs. Sure. Go through what?
Okay, so like with the debranching enzyme. Uh-huh.
Go to library, Kobe.
I guess I'm just confused where the one sits right
now. Why don't it's easier if I show you on a figure, Megan, I think, than to probably try to describe it to you. Why don't I put the get the camera set up? If you want to come down, then I'll give you. I'll show you down there. I'll be down in my office. Yeah.
I just want to double check about the note card. We can do both sides.
Yes, ma'am. You can do the edge if you can write on the edge.
Okay. Thank you. I had a regrade. Is that in your office or?
It's in the biochem office.
Okay.
So come by there. Okay.
Are they open right now?
No, that'd be Monday.
Okay.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
I have a question for you.
Yes.
So I was actually studying for Indira's class last night.
You poor thing.
I know. I'm thinking it's actually kind of fun because I'm thinking at the same time.
Yep.
So it's like kind of the same topics. But so epinephrine releases glucose into your system.
Mm-hmm.
Then why do we give epinephrine if you're having an anaphylactic shock reaction?
Epinephrine has other effects. Epinephrine actually stimulates your heart. And so one of the things that happens with anaphylactic shock is your blood pressure goes way low.
Yeah.
And so you're stimulating the heart to just keep doing its thing in spite of that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So that has... That isn't directly related to the glucose phenomenon, but it will stimulate the heart.
Okay. Which I guess makes sense because if you're producing more glucose because your body needs more glucose, you also want the glucose to be able to travel through your blood system faster.
Right.
So it's saying, hey, heart pump fast, hey, also liver.
But epinephrine's a good stimulant of the heart.
Yeah. Which makes also sense because when you have a patient crash, you give them epinephrine to get their heart
that's right.
going also.
Yep.
Okay.
Okay.
Cool. Thank you.
You bet. Hi.
For glycogen phosphorylase, is the phosphate on A or B?
So with glycogen phosphorylase, the phosphorylated form is the A form.
The A form?
Yes.
Okay, so why is there a phosphate coming off of B? Or is it
that's
coming
A.
off of A?
That's the T state of A.
Okay. And then this is just...
And that's the phosphate, and so this now becomes B once it's lost the phosphate.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah.
So it still has the phosphate here. That's the phosphate showing right there because that is the T state. It's still glycogen phosphorylase A.
Okay?
Thank
you.
Sure. Okay.